Hey guys, here with another episode on Training Confidential, and we're training chess today. We're talking about chess training today. I got Donnie here. How you doing, Donnie?
Not bad, man. How you doing?
Good, good. I got my son here. I'm sure you guys seen him in other videos. He's a
there
star
he is,
in the videos.
My man.
So anyway, I want to start off with chess. Chess is they're all equally as good, but it's probably my favorite one to train nowadays, I think, just because of the fact that I went from no chess to having a chess, and I learned the process of how to build a chess, and you know, it wasn't easy, and you know, it was very rewarding. So first I want to talk about the importance of chess for the physique first stage competition style.
So as far as from a posing standpoint, from a strategic standpoint, I'm going to start with the side first, because the obvious one is the side chest. Okay, I mean, yeah, the highlight is the chest. The high, and there are other things that are involved in it too, but the highlight is the chest. I mean, you know, Arnold, who was known for having a very devastating chest, side chest was one of his best poses and stuff. But the thing about it is this: almost any side pose, bar from the three quarter back, and maybe that side bicep, the chest is equally as important. As a matter of fact, like, take for instance that side tricep. That side tricep is almost imperative. There's a huge difference between someone who hits a hot side tricep and has a shallow chest as opposed to someone that does the same pose with a thicker chest, you know.
Yes.
So the pose is not just the tricep. You know, you got the shoulders involved in it. You got the chest involved in it. You got the abs involved in it. And like I said, if you got a nice thick chest, that just really accentuates that side tricep. Any pose like the Munzer, the Ferrigno, any of these poses that you do on the side, and you got a thick chest to go with it, it's really going to take it to the next level and stuff. Now, as far as the front goes, you know, you got it most muscular, you know. You know, your crab most muscular, your thigh most muscular, and even to some respect, that box most muscular. Because one of the things that you're showing is not so much the traps, but you're showing the striations across the chest.
Yes.
Especially with that thigh most muscular. You push in on that stuff and those striations come out and stuff, you know? So, yeah, as far as most muscular poses and side poses in general, side triceps, Ferrigno's, Munzer, anything that accentuates the chest, you know, it's essential to have it. It's definitely going to take it a step above everything else.
So, developing a chest, you know, we got three muscles in the chest. We got the upper, the middle, and the lower chest. And what is primarily the best part to, I guess the right word for it is, should you hit all the heads? Can you do certain exercises? I mean, what is the most, as far as a bodybuilding standpoint, where do you want the most thickness at, I guess, in your chest?
So you got to go at it pretty much like you go with back. Basically, you have two chest muscles. You got the pectoralis major and you got the minor. Okay, and you don't really see the minor because it's actually underneath. You know, so you just basically got this chest up top here. This is the major right here, okay. And like I said, the minor's underneath it and stuff. But you're right. You're gonna break it down to like upper and lower, pretty much. Okay. And we're talking about, so basically you have the chest. You have basically two movements. The chest pushes things away from you and allows you to hold on to things. You know, and so then you have, you know, some kind of bench press along with a fly, and pretty much everything is covered. Now, the thing about it is this, you can get a little specialized and stuff. Everybody needs to do some upper chest work. Everybody does, because you want to get that shelf up there and stuff, you know, that's pretty much everybody. But the thing about it is this, some people need more lower chest than others. On average, most of the average person doesn't really need to do anything specialized. If they do enough flat benches or they knock out some dips or just doing flat flies and stuff, you know, they're going to be pretty good. But then you got some people, and one bodybuilder that comes into mind, Mike Mentzer, you know.
Yes.
Mike Mentzer had tremendous triceps, and the thing about it is when he bench pressed, He often mentioned that, you know, his if he does not pre-exhaust his chest, you know, his triceps are going to get the brunt of the work. So he may start out with some flies first to isolate that chest muscle, you know, really get that puppy fatigued. So when he does go into the heavy compound moves, you know, the triceps are still fresh and the chest is getting the brunt of the work, you know. Mm-hmm. So, but, you know, not everybody has that problem, you know, and so they don't necessarily have to do it. I did declines back in the day simply because I just wanted to experience it. I never really had to do declines to actually develop my chest because it was probably one of the first things that developed them. It's just one of the things that developed really easy and stuff. And that's why I kind of like doing it over the years and stuff, you know. But yeah, if you want to start with an incline, a flat, and a fly, that pretty much does it, you know, for most folks. And then if you really need to specialize, like to really get a little bit more fullness in that lower chest, then you may want to do something like a decline, but you can even do a dip or something like that to kind of help out with that.
So when you got some guys that have my chest kind of developed equally, I think, as it grew, but you got some guys that kind of grow just in the middle, you know what I mean? And they have no outer chest tying into their shoulders. For the guys like that, what would you, how do you
flies?
Build? Yeah, flies. Okay. Stretching
flies. Okay. And you could, yeah, when you come, you can actually, yeah, you can feel that tie in and stuff. So flies would definitely be the way to go and stuff, you know, and you can either pre-exhaust, you know, by pre-exhausting, your strength is at its highest. So now you can fly a little bit heavier and stuff, you know? So, but yeah, flies definitely be the way. Cable flies, dumbbell flies, machine flies, you know, mm-hmm. It really doesn't matter. As long as you get the recruiting principles in, you recruit those fibers and you tear them down, you know, the more you recruit, I don't care what you're doing, machines, cables, dumbbell, you know, it doesn't matter, you know, but just apply those, that recruiting principle and you should be good to go.
What do you think about I don't know that it worked for an older person because we don't have the growth hormone as a younger person does, but, you know, Arnold did the pullovers. He'd always superset, you know, like flies with pullovers to expand the chest, you know, to gain more area for the chest to grow.
Right. Now, the thing with pullovers, and it's funny you mention that because actually you have some transition exercises, and that's what I call them, transition mm-hmm. exercises. So basically back in the day, a very popular split used to be chest and back.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. They would train chest and back together. There's no way I would do that today, but I did it back in the day. I did. Okay. And the purpose of it was the pullover, what it did was if you trained your back first, it would be a great way to finish your lats off. And at the same time, it kind of gets your chest warmed up, you know, to go into chest training or just the opposite. If you finish your chest training and you're getting ready to do back now, you're going to finish off with pullovers. And what that does, it finishes off the chest, but at the same time, it warms those lats up to get grounded and stuff. So that's it's a transition exercise. And there's another one, and I'm losing thought of what it is.
Well, you do,
that's like, another muscle group.
Arnold would also do the, I think, the bench press, barbell bench press, that you do pull-ups right afterwards.
Chest and back was a very, very, very popular split. As a matter of fact, it was probably the first split that I did. Chest, back, shoulders, arms, and legs. Huh. 3 days a week.
So we talked about kind of the exercises, which basically it's just a press in different angles is pretty much how you can get. How far of an angle incline do you suggest to actually press before you're getting into your shoulders too much?
Right. And that's a rule of thumb. So the rule of thumb is, of course, the flatter the bench is, the more you're hitting your chest. And as you start going, you're still in chest. I would say right here, you're still in chest. But if you start getting up to here, you're probably hitting shoulders here. I'm probably about right about here on that angle is where I'm at and stuff, you know. I don't want to be too high up and stuff, you know. You know, to where I'm going to be feeling in my shoulders, but I'm more flatter than I am on an incline.
Cool. Awesome. So let's talk about abs a little bit now. abs kind of go with the, we're kind of just doing the front, I guess now, you know, next, I think next is arms, right? I think that's the last of our series. Yeah. So abs, you know, this is one of those things that I've always been on the consensus. You got to do abs constantly and, you know, 5 sets every day and all this stuff. And honestly with me, I always have abs even on the off season, and I, and the off season, I may or may not do abs each workout. I don't really make it a priority, you know, cause I feel like I get my, I'm not losing my abs and they're not going anywhere. But then when I get into prep, I do abs every day, you know? So how important is it? Is it just me, or is this something that the average person can get away with? How often do they have to train abs to get them?
Abs is one of those abstract things. It's one of the things, they say it's one of the few muscle that you can do every day. Mm-hmm. Okay. Because to do them doesn't require a lot of energy, you know. Yeah. Abs and calves you can do pretty much every day and stuff. And as a matter of fact, I mean, I became an abaholic, I'd say about probably 74, 75, to where I was doing 100 crunches, 100 sit-ups, and 100 twists a day. I was doing that about 5 days a week. And this is a 14-year-old kid doing it. Once, you know, I had a gut because I was a little chunky kid. And one day I just woke up, it's about 3 years into it, and the light just hit the mirror just right, and I saw an ab, you know.
Yeah, nice.
And I just went ape gaga after that and stuff, and just started doing. I did Frank Zane's ab routine, and I did what's his name again? Bill Grant's ab routine. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember the issue of Muscle and Fitness that Bill Grant's routine was in, and I did that until I graduated high school. You know,
nice.
I did that routine and stuff, you know. And so my very first when they were doing body part awards back in the 70s, and best abdominals was the first trophy that I ever got. And I got most of my awards for best abdominals. And basically with ab work, it's just consistency, just being consistent, you know. And, you know, and I'd say about minimum 3 days a week, absolute minimum 3 days a week, you know. And then, you know, I did some weight bearing stuff, but I have like big ab muscles anyway.
Yeah, that was another question I was going to ask. Like,
so I have these round muscle, and I didn't do anything special to do that. It's just, I guess that's just my makeup. You know what I mean? Yeah. You know, I've done some weighted stuff, but mostly it was just plain up sit-ups, leg raises, and side bends.
Okay. So, and that was kind of the consensus I was under. You don't need to have heavy weight with abs. I mean, you know, it's just about repetition.
Yeah, depending. And some intensity. Some people have very, very, very flat ab muscles and stuff, you know. And the flatter they are, then the leaner you got to get in order to see them. You know what I mean? I mean, there have been times where I was like 11, 12% body fat, and still you could see my abs, you know. And not because I was really leaning down. It's just that I had big ab muscles and stuff. Okay.
You know, maybe I'm that type then.
You know,
because I mean, I probably do abs 3 days a week, easy, but it's not, you know, it's just a lot of times I have a crunch for time, and I always get my calves in, but the abs are all, you know, but then prep, like I said, I do them every day, all the way up to showtime.
Mm-hmm.
But I never lose them, but I do get the feeling sometimes like I got to hit them. You know, and I don't know if it's maybe the flat look or what it is. It's probably a look, but my mind says I need to go hit them, so I do. You know, and my abs never came in anyway until I got lean, really. You know,
right.
It's like, because I did abs, you know, all day long, pretty much. I did a lot of abs, and I never seen my abs.
That was me.
You know,
that
period of time.
Yeah, that was me mostly in the 90s. I know in the late 80s. You know, I was doing a show in Germany and stuff, you know, and the judges, they got with me and said, okay, you've been doing too much. My abs were kind of overshadowing everything else, you know. Oh. And so this, you need to probably back off on your ab work a little bit. And at that point, I know all during my 30s, I really didn't train abs until I'd say about 6 weeks from the show. 6 weeks left in prep and stuff. This is when I started doing abs and stuff, and that was fine for me then. So
I'm glad you said that because I wanted to talk about overtraining abs next. So
right, they kind of don't, and the waist was a little thick because I was doing a lot of oblique work and stuff, you know. So I just cut out oblique work at that point, all together and stuff. And then, like I said, I wouldn't train abs until 6 weeks prior to the show.
Yeah, I remember one time you see me doing some obliques and you got on me for doing them. Right. You don't need those right now. So, and I totally get it because, you know, it responds quick and it heals quick, the abs do. So, yeah. So, well, I think that's our chest and ab talk. You got anything else? Speaking of Mensur, I seen a video today about can you really do just one set or of one exercise? I don't want to say his name, but anyway, on the video, and he was saying that's impossible to do, basically. But he wasn't saying it was impossible. He was saying it was the intensity level. So, which is one thing that I think we've highlighted a lot, is that you can't just go and do one set and call it good unless that intensity is at the utmost highest that you could possibly output at that moment in time. You know, right. It has to be failure. You know,
one analogy I use is, think of a game of darts, okay? And you got 3 darts to hit the bullseye, and I only have 1, you know? So you got 2 shots. You know, you have 3 chances to hit the bullseye, okay? You can miss the first 2 and be off and then hit it on the last one. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But me, I've only got 1 shot, which means that load has got to be completely dialed in for a single set, you know? Loads can be dialed in to hit you in 1 set, 2 set, 3 set, 4 sets, 5 sets, you know?
Yeah.
You know, if you're trying to get the same results in 1 set that you do in 5 sets, that set and that load and that volume has got to be right on the money. If it's right on the money, and when you're done, it's golden.
Yeah, yeah. And that was, you know, they were talking about Dorian and Mensur, because they train like that. And then the guy said, well, look at how they trained. You know, they took everything to the absolute finish on every set. And that's the reason they were able to get what they got out of that.
But what a lot of people don't understand is that they use multiple exercises, though.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Volume's still there.
Yeah, we're doing 1 set. But, like, let's say back. But I'm doing about 6 to 7 different exercises.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, so it's 6 or 7 exercises that you're going like that. And you can't do that for like 15, 20, nope. 25 sets. There's no way you can do that. That's impossible.
The same thing was the same video they were talking about. This one guy had this workout routine or something, and you take a weight that your ultimate failure is at 12 reps, right? So at 12 reps, then you rack it up for 15 seconds, and then you pump out 20 reps, you rest pause 20 reps until you get it. Well, this dude was a power lifter, so he does his 12. He does his 12 reps. Then he gets 1, and then he gets 1. And like, he didn't even finish it because he took it to absolute failure. But yet the guy said you should be able to get 5, and it's like, well, you didn't take it to failure at 12. Then obviously, if you're getting 5 right after that,
you know? So yeah. So the rest pause system actually. It came from strongman. It's part of strongman routines and stuff. Mike Mensur is the one that just brought it over to the bodybuilding realm and stuff. But it was used by strongmen way back in the day. It's an old training principle and stuff. I mean, it goes back to the 50s, you know. But they didn't. I think they called it back then. They called it like the California set or some stuff like that. And then evolved into the rest pause and stuff. But that was strongman used and stuff. But Mensur, he just took it, you know, and it was part of his heavy duty principle and stuff. And he applied it to bodybuilding. That's all it is.
Yeah.
Arnold kind of did something similar to it. Arnold would do something like the hundreds, you know, they would do like 100 and they would just keep pumping and stop and take a little bit and just keep pumping them until it was done. And then, you know, they go to something else. You know,
yeah, he did a lot.
We do 20s.
Yeah, he did a lot of drop sets and stuff like that. Arnold would do, but it was to failure. You know, he would basically put in his workout, and then at the end of it, he would have a max effort day, and whatever compound lift he's going to do with drop sets onto it. Right. I did his routine a long time ago, and it was a hardcore routine. But you're in the gym for like 2 hours.
Yeah, I mean it's baked into the cake. I mean it's part of the plan and stuff. You know, the failure part of it.
That's fun though. Yeah. All right, you guys. Next week we're going to talk about arms, and we're going to go from there. So thanks for watching. Like,
well, it looks like somebody's already reached failure.
Yeah, it's a failure time right now. All right, you guys have a good night. Good night, Donnie.
All right, man.